Welcome to the Psychology Podcast, where we give you insights into the mind, brain, behavior, and creativity. I'm Dr. Scott Barry Kaufman, and in each episode, I have a conversation with a guest who will stimulate your mind and give you a greater understanding of yourself, others, and the world we live in. Hopefully, we'll also provide a glimpse into human possibility. Thanks for listening and enjoy the podcast. So today we have Nicholas Christakis on the podcast. Christakis is a physician and sociologist who explores the ancient origins and modern implications of human nature. He directs the Human Nature Lab at Yale University, where he is the Sterling Professor of Social and Natural Science in the departments of Sociology, Medicine, Ecology and Evolutionary Biology, Statistics and Data Science, and Biomedical Engineering. He's also the co-director of the Yale Institute for Network Science, the co-author of the book Connected, and most recently author of the book Blueprint, The Evolutionary Origins of a Good Society, which on its first week became a New York Times bestseller. Nicholas, so great to chat with you today.
Thank you so much for having me, Scott.
Boy, you are involved in lots of departments at Yale. Which department are you not part of? Is it like, what are you not part of over there?
Well, I have, you know, I think one of the benefits of an academic life is the ability to explore lots of ideas and fields. You know, I think depth is important, but so is breadth. Typically, people begin with depth, right? They start their career and they're very focused. They learn something in detail. They really try to master or discover new knowledge about something. But then I think ideally you put your head up and you start looking around and explore other fields, initially perhaps be adjacent to your own, and then further and further afield. And so in my own case, you know, as my career has unfolded, I mean, I always was interested in a variety of topics, but I have been progressively able to read more broadly and become interested more broadly. And because of the academic life allows us this, I've been able to pursue a number of fields. I think chemistry is probably next up on my...
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah. There's so many different levels of analysis to address the issue. Well, of the, I was going to say the good society, but
yeah.
What would you say is like the issue though for you? I don't want to put words in your mouth. Is there, what's the common theme? Yeah.
Well, I think that, I mean, since you framed the opening question that way, I mean, I'll answer it in two ways. First of all, I will say that for too long, in my view, scientists have been overly interested in the dark side of human nature, you know, in our capacity for tribalism and selfishness and hatred and violence. But equally, we are capable of love and friendship and cooperation and teaching and learning. And so I think one of the kind of bigger frames with respect to the intellectual scope of the book, as you asked, has to do with this desire to push back using a number of fields, evolutionary biology and the social sciences, genetics, and even network science, to push back at this conception of human beings as being inveterately bad. Because in fact, the benefits of a connected life must have outweighed the costs, or we wouldn't be living socially. If I always came near you and, you know, you killed me or were mendacious to me or brutal to me, I wouldn't approach you, and nobody would approach anyone. We'd live solitary lives. And the second big way, like the knowledge from all of these diverse fields is relevant to the problem before us, which is, you know, how and why do we live socially, is the following. You know, I think there's been a lot of interest lately, especially because of Steven Pinker's work on the social effects of the Enlightenment. So there's no doubt that in the last 200 years, given the developments, the philosophical orientations and scientific discoveries associated with the Enlightenment, that human beings are living vastly better lives, that we are safer, we're less murderous, we live longer, we have better health, better wealth, in every possible regard. But I don't think we need to look solely at historical forces to understand the origins of a good life. I think actually deeper, more powerful, more ancient forces are at work as well. Evolutionary forces that have shaped our evolution, shaped us as an animal, shaped our capacity for living socially, and in fact equipped us with all of these qualities to be good, to make good societies, societies that are on balance, further our interests. So this breadth of fields, I think, is required if one is to understand a problem of this kind, ranging, as I just said, from history to evolutionary biology. And so that's why I think the way in which this diversity of fields, perspectives, and interests can be useful, and in fact, I hope, is captured by the book.
Wonderful. What broad worthy goals you have there set out for yourself. But you also have a sort of, I see this ravenous curiosity aspect of you. So not just the caring about making society a better place, but it seems like you really want to triangulate as much sources of information to try to get at the truth as possible. Is that fair?
Yeah, I mean, I think that is fair. I think the truth is difficult to see. I mean, I think the one thing we should stipulate from the beginning, I think the truth is knowable. I think it's out there. I think there is an objective reality. I recognize that science is imperfect. It's a human activity, you know, prone to failures. But I think it's a falsehood. It's a nonsense to believe that there is no out there. But it's hard to see. And I think what you see depends on where you stand. Well, I mean, I think the more places you stand, the more perspectives you have on what it is that you're trying to see, the more likely you are to see it, the more likely you are to see it correctly. I think it's quite dangerous to stand in one perspective. You may not appreciate what's going on. In fact, you can even use a metaphor from physics of inertial frames. You know, if you're standing in a train and you juggling balls, your whole world is this train and moving train, and the whole world is these balls that are juggling, and you just think they're moving at a certain velocity through space. But actually, an observer outside the train in a different inertial frame sees that the balls actually have a completely different kind of motion than you think. So, you know, what you see, of course, depends on where you stand. But I think additional perspectives, as we said, you know, shed more light on the truth.
Yeah, for sure. So your book is simultaneously bluntly realistic about human nature while optimistic about human nature. So I like that, by the way. I like that. And you always kind of maybe see one or the other. So I'm going to like combine two statements from your book. So the very interesting question you posed, which I tweeted out because I thought it was such an interesting question: can you love your own group without hating everyone else? And then here's another question you pose in your book: how can crowds be a force for good? And I was wondering if you could just kind of riff on the integration of those two questions.
Well, I think that we evolved this capacity for tribalism or in-group bias or homophily. These are slightly different concepts, but they're all similar. They're the idea that, you know, we prefer the company of people we resemble, or we think more highly of the company of people we resemble. Resemble defined in whatever way. It needn't be, you know, superficial characteristics. It could be your religion or your language or where you're from or what kind of food you like or all kinds of traits that people, you know, there are these famous experiments that have been done with toddlers that I discuss in the book. You randomly assign toddlers T-shirts of a different color, and all of a sudden the blue T-shirt wearing kids think the red T-shirt wearing kids are less deserving of toys and are, you know, morally deficient just from this minimal group manipulation of the trivial assignment of different T-shirt colors. So it's very easy to elicit this us versus them inclination in human beings. And it is, as I discuss, this in-group bias is a part of our human nature. It's unavoidable. There are arguments that I discuss in the book, and I don't think the science is settled on the evolutionary function of this predilection. So some people think that, and I think it's probably true, that the evolution of cooperation required the evolution of in-group bias. And so in order to have kindliness within, you needed to have warlikeliness without. That is to say, in order for me to be able to selectively cooperate with individuals and get the benefits of cooperation, I needed to be able to define my group. And therefore, in my group, we cooperate with each other, whereas between groups, we have animosity or we don't cooperate with each other. First point. The second point, however, is that the, you know, sort of indifference to other groups is distinct from hatred of other groups. So it's still unclear, you know, you could have a preference for your own group and neutral feelings to other groups. So the origins of this sort of animosity, you know, there's a big difference between thinking ill of other groups and sending them to gas chambers. And, you know, so we still don't, I think, have a full accounting of the origins of that kind of hatred, although we can know its historical impact. We know that malicious leaders can whip groups into a frenzy. They can, as I talk about in the book, they can exploit this innate tendency in people and manipulate it so that they actually develop hatred of other people. So the first, I think, our answer to you is that in-group bias, tribalism and in-group bias are an inherent part of our human nature. But I don't see a necessary reason for us to hate other people. And furthermore, natural selection has equipped us with two other abilities to efface the impact of tribalism. And so one of the challenges in living socially is the ability to get along with other people and to derive benefits from being near other people. And so we shouldn't be surprised to find that we have several tools that make it easier for us. For example, one of the arguments I make in the book is that the capacity for friendship to have a special attachment to particular individuals is also connected with the evolution of cooperation. So rather than cooperating blithely with every other human, the population has what is known as structure. So we're not all jostling around like in a herd of cattle, each of us cooperating with everyone else. No, each of us has our own unique friends. Everyone has some friends, and each of us is cooperating with those friends. And it kind of congeals the whole population into this cooperative matrix because we've added this structure. And there's a lot of experimental and mathematical evidence that the addition of network structure to a population facilitates the emergence of cooperation. So it's not just that the definition of us versus them facilitates cooperation. Network structure can do it too. Furthermore, and now I'll get to the answer, if you think about populations as having like some large population composed of individuals, so at the top you have this like large population, at the bottom you have the individuals, and in between you have groups within the population. If you find the groupiness problematic, as I do, there are a couple of other tools that evolution has equipped us with to cope with this. So one solution is to go up a level to the level of the large group. Because we can define the boundaries ourselves, they're not God-given, they're not innate, we can expand those boundaries and come to think about being members of the entire group. And if you think about our history in the United States, you know, there was a kind of idea about the American project, that anybody could be an American. And, you know, de Tocqueville talks about us being a nation of joiners. You can self-define as an American. We all have, you know, this kind of a pluribus unum, you know, we're all united. And so you can exploit this tendency for us to be affiliated with groups and define the group up so that you, let's say you're defined on the level of nationality rather than the level of constituent group. Or you could go down a level to the level of individuals. Because one of the other things that's really unusual about us as a species is that we have this capacity to express and recognize individual identity. In fact, one of the paradoxes of social life is that we have to be able to express individuality in order to live socially. So we do that with our faces. Each of our faces is unique. It's actually evolutionarily costly. It's a luxury that we all have unique faces. It needn't have been that way. We all could have had the same face. Why do we not all have the same face? We all have different looking faces. And you can recognize your friends from the appearance of their faces, but you cannot recognize your friends from the appearance of their hands. And in fact, hands look more similar to each other. Pairs, you know, each person's hands are more similar to each other than each person's faces.
Speak for yourself.
So the capacity to express and recognize individual identity is evolutionarily costly. There's a lot of brain power that's going into that. And this is not a coincidence, and it is related to the necessity of cooperation and living socially. You need to be able to distinguish one person from another. Who is my offspring and who's not my offspring? Who was nice to me? Who was not nice to me? Hmm. Who is my friend? Who is my enemy? And so the argument here is that we can go down a level from tribalism and start seeing people as individuals. And evolution has equipped us with this capacity to recognize that we're all individuals. Go down a level. And this is, in essence, Martin Luther King's argument, that everyone should be judged by the content of their character, not the color of their skin. So even in the American tradition, you see, we have both of these traditions, these philosophical, political traditions in our society, I would argue, which are built on these ancient, primitive evolutionary foundations, and which give us tools to combat the tribalism, which, you know, I see as a depressing feature, undue tribalism, which I see as a tribalism that involves hatred of other groups. I'm not so worried about tribalism that, you know, say I like my group, but I'm neutral to other groups. Anyway, so that's my answer to that question. I don't know if it's a good answer, but it's where I'm thinking right now.
Thank you. It's a very thought-provoking answer, for sure. And, you know, it's got me thinking about lots of different things. So one of the fields I work in is positive psychology. And like the positive psychologist in me like almost wants to reframe your question to like, because like the whole point of positive psychology is like -5 to 0 is not the same as 0 to 20, like flourishing. So like, can you love your own group and love other groups? Like, that's my question too. It's like not just going to neutral.
Do you think love or positive regard is zero sum? You think we're limited in our capacity to think highly of other people? That Buddhist monks can train themselves.
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. So what I'm making a distinction here is something that I'm starting to distinguish in my work between the need for belonging and connection and the need for universal love. And, you know, we can have like universal love without even like liking people, you know?
Yes. So, yes, that's a good distinction.
Well, thank you. I'm so glad you think so.
But I think it's possible they're different feelings. I think it's possible the love you feel, we use the same word love, but perhaps we shouldn't. So I think that your kind of love for one's love for humanity, for which I think there's a word, it's escaping me right now. The Greeks, you know, philanthropy, let's say, that might be a good word to use. So philanthropy, in the strict Greek meaning of the word, you know, love of human beings, might be rather different than love of an individual. So even though you use the same word love, there might be two different feelings or experiences or phenomena there that you're distinguishing.
That's right. And how can we, you know, have great admiration and pride for our in-group while truly respecting that other people are equally admire their own in-group as well? Like, you know, have the society where like we kind of treat groups as sacred and recognize that our group is not necessarily the most sacred group, but, you know, like we can still have admiration.
That's very combustible, of course, right? You know, one of the things I find so interesting about, you know, the work of the anthropologists in the 20th century is that they spanned out around the world as, you know, of course, as part of the colonial project.
Yeah.
And they encountered, you know, peoples all over the world and traditional, you know, forager populations, for example, or agro-pastoralists. And in most of those cases, the people's word for their own people was the people. In other words, you know, in this language, what do you call your own group? Oh, we're the people. So everyone, you know, every group thinks they're the chosen ones, right? So I don't know if you're right that philosophical stance would be entirely benign. You know, I worry that would in fact lead rather quickly to, well, wait a minute, we can't both be, you know, the people. You know, one of us has to be on top.
Am I being perhaps too optimistic? Because
No, I share your optimism. I'm just saying I'm not sure that's the way to achieve it.
Okay.
You're saying why don't we just try to frame the problem as one of our group is sacred, but we recognize that other groups can be sacred. That's an extra step. I think that's an extra demand compared to the idea we were discussing earlier, which is why can't we just have people say, my group is terrific and I have neutral feelings
to other
groups.
Neutrality, yeah.
Because you're asking that not only, you don't just want me to think my group is terrific, you want me to think my group is sacred. Furthermore, you want me to grant that other groups also think they're sacred. I mean, maybe they can do that. I'm a little nervous about your proposal, is all I'm saying.
Fair enough. You know, sometimes I can think very utopia, you know, about things. Well, you know.
I like that. We kindred spirit, our utopianism is a kindred.
Oh, yes. And we're going to discuss our late triad scores later, which are similar levels. I'd like to take a moment to talk about an app I use regularly to help me reduce stress and increase my well-being. It's called Headspace, and it's truly your guide to health and happiness. In just a few minutes a day, Headspace will teach you the life-changing skills of meditation and mindfulness. Meditation is deeply rooted in tradition, but is also backed by scientific research. Research has found that 4 weeks of Headspace improved focus by 14%, and 10 days of Headspace increased happiness by 5%. Headspace has hundreds of meditation sessions on everything from stress to sleep. There are a number of guided exercises to help you add a touch of mindfulness to daily activities like cooking, commuting, eating, and more. Personally, I like to use the meditation app called Stressed. The exercise helps me notice what I'm holding on to and how to drop the storyline, allowing me to reframe stressful situations. So I have some good news. We have a special deal today for listeners of the Psychology Podcast. Start your journey towards a healthier life by subscribing to Headspace, and you can fire up your browser and go to headspace.com/TPP to get a free month trial. To repeat, sign up online at headspace.com/TPP for a free month trial and start meditating today. I've been really interested in narcissism, but you know, I started off really interested in individual narcissism, but now I'm really interested in collective group narcissism.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, and I think it might be relevant to this discussion. So the same principles that operate by like individual narcissism, like the distinction between having a secure self-esteem versus a narcissistic self-esteem, is the difference between just merely feeling like you're worthy, like self-worth, versus I am better, than others. Like, you can have a great stable sense of self-worth without feeling like you're better than others. But
yes.
So recently, research psychologists had created this construct called collective narcissism, where you elevate your group as superior to other groups. And I've just been trying to think, like, well, applying the same principles, like, isn't, like, stable, secure self-esteem groups possible? Like, it doesn't have to be. Like, collective narcissism doesn't have to exist. There are people with stable self-esteem who report much greater levels of happiness in life and life satisfaction and meaning and purpose. It seems to me like there's a healthier way forward with groups where you, maybe it's exactly what you're saying. Like, we have this, you know, great pride in our group, which is great. But we don't need to rely on others for validation of that greatness. Like, we don't have to constantly be telling others that we're great. Like, we can actually have this stable sense of pride within. So I just wanted to just riff on this a little bit.
Well, I it's a new idea to me. It doesn't, or new framing of this idea to me. It doesn't strike me as crazy. I think that there are many emotions which we customarily or temperaments which we customarily think of as being individually based could have collective analogs. So, for example, we're accustomed to thinking about this in the terms of happiness, for instance, or so you can have a group can be happy and not just an individual, or fear. You know, an individual can be afraid, or a group can be panicking or rioting, for example, with anger or whatever. So I think a quality like narcissism, I absolutely do think you could have a kind of collective narcissism that you're discussing. Now, whether that, whether that gives us additional purchase on the topic before us, I don't know, but my bias would be yes, let's approach it from that point of view and give it some thought.
Thank you for entertaining it at least.
Yeah. No, I mean, I think what can we learn about this kind of collective, you know, the secure kind of sense of confidence versus the kind of deficient kind of narcissistic sense. What can we use from our understanding of these principles as has been developed in the case of individuals to understand the functioning of groups? So I think that's an interesting idea.
Well, thank you.
Did I summarize your argument correctly?
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. So thank you. So many interesting intersections between psychology and the work you're doing. You know, like all this stuff is.
My best friends are psychologists.
Yeah, they're intertwined. Do you by any chance intersect with Molly Crockett over there at Yale?
Yeah, I know Molly. I think very highly of her. I've only met her a few times. Her lab is across the street from mine.
Oh, cool.
And of course, Dan Gilbert is a very close personal friend. I've known him for a very long time. Steve Pinker and a whole bunch of Paul Bloom. I mean, I hang out with a bunch of psychologists.
Well, maybe you'll add Scott Barry Kaufman to the list today.
Yes. Delighted to do that.
Yeah. So actually, Molly Crockett's psychology podcast episode is dropping today.
Yeah.
And yours will drop next week. So, So I thought that'd be a nice like pairing.
Yes.
So you talk in your book about the social suite of features of humanity. And I was wondering if you could mention some of the members of the social suite and why you think that it's important to think this way.
Well, I mean, the part of human nature that interests me is that part that we express interindividually. So there are, of course, many parts of human nature. This includes, for instance, your propensity to fear or wanderlust, your intelligence is a part of human nature, curiosity. I mean, there are lots of qualities which are, you know, instinctive or natural, which are instantiated within individuals. But the part that I'm interested in is the part that we express between ourselves, interindividually, and that are relevant to our ability to live together. So what qualities has natural selection equipped us with to be able to live socially in the way that we do? Incidentally, these same qualities, I argue in the book, are found in other animals, such as elephants and whales and certain other primates, which have, by convergent evolution and independently, also evolved similar qualities, for example, capacity for friendship or pair bonding or cooperation and so forth, which we'll get to in a moment. So this convergent evolution of these qualities in other animal species, other social mammals, further vindicates my confidence that these qualities are crucial parts of living socially. And so the list of these qualities includes the capacity for individual identity, which we talked a little bit about already, that paradoxically, in order to live socially, we have to have individuality. Love. When you think of the human virtues, when you think of our virtues, they are social virtues. We don't care whether you love yourself or are kind to yourself or are just to yourself. We care whether you love others or are kind to others or are just to others. And so our virtues are social virtues primarily. So love is the second part of the social suite. You know, the fact that we love our mates is unusual in the animal kingdom, and it's something that's expressed interindividually. Then I discuss friendship. I include friendship in this, our capacity for friendship. Again, unusual in the animal kingdom. We form long-term, non-reproductive unions to conspecifics. Why do we do that? Other animals don't do that. We do. Elephants do it. Certain whale species, certain primate species. It's rare that we do this. So individual identity, love, friendship, social networks. Because of our capacity to form friendships, we form ourselves into networks, something I've been thinking about for a very long time, obviously. And these networks have very particular mathematical properties, which actually confer advantages on groups in ways we can discuss if you're interested. And then continuing the list, we have what I would call a sort of a cooperation. And I don't call it, everyone calls it cooperation. Cooperation, our tendency to cooperate with each other, and this creates multiplicative benefits for the individuals participating in cooperative exchanges, and is the kind of core of how groups are together. In-group bias, this thing we've already discussed a little, this tendency to prefer and think more highly of your own group. Mild, what I call mild hierarchy. So our groups are structured, I think, innately to manifest mild hierarchy. And here I rely on work by many primatologists, and including some fascinating experimental work by Jessica Flack and her colleagues, manipulating primate hierarchy and exploring what happens when you eliminate hierarchy in these groups. And then I have a whole argument in the book relying on natural experiments with shipwrecks and so forth that looks at, you know, the role of hierarchy. And finally, our capacity for social learning and teaching. We don't just learn. I mean, many organisms learn. You know, worms can learn. A little fish in the ocean can learn that if it swims towards the light, it finds food. We learn socially, which is extremely efficient. So you can learn by putting your hand in the fire and pulling it out that the fire burns you. Or I can watch you put your hand in the fire, and I learn almost as much but pay none of the cost. That's very efficient. But we don't just learn socially, we actually affirmatively teach each other. And that also is very rare in the animal kingdom, animals that affirmatively set out to teach each other stuff. That capacity, of course, lies at the root of our capacity for culture. That's the foundation for our ability to be a cultural animal, and therefore to express, in fact, to have manifested a kind of social conquest of the earth. I think other than ants or something, we are the species with the widest ecological range. And we do this not because of changes in our body, but because of our capacity for culture. You know, we can make parkas and live in the Arctic and make canoes and live in the equator. And so this capacity we have to transmit knowledge across space and time, you know, to learn over generations and preserve that knowledge is the last part of the social suite, this teaching function. So those are the eight elements of the social suite, and that I think are essential parts of our nature that have been shaped by natural selection and that make it possible for us to live socially the way we do.
Cool. Thank you. I liked how you put that all together into like one cohesive list. That was helpful for me. So thank you.
Yeah.
So you talk about intentional versus intentional communities. Can you please distinguish between those and maybe give an example of each?
Well, I mean, that part of the book begins with a sequence of explorations of what's been called the forbidden experiment. So if, you know, in the mind of a deranged scientist such as you and me, you know, the ideal experiment would be to, you know, take a group of babies and abandon them on an island, you know, acultural babies, and abandon them on an island, and somehow they would grow up, you know, without parenting, let's say. Then we would ask, well, what kind of society would they make for themselves? You know, just like you might ask, you know, what kind of body are you innately pre-wired to make? You know, you're born with certain genetic predispositions, towards diabetes, towards a certain height, towards whatever. Obviously, the environment is very important. You know, if I starve you when you're a child, you won't be as tall and you'll have other risk for diabetes and so forth, altered risk for diabetes. So the environment is crucial. But, you know, there's some sense in which your body is programmed to be a certain kind of body based on the genes that you were born with. Well, the same argument might be I do make is with respect to societies. You know, what kind of society is innately part of our human nature? So the experiment that I would love to do is to, you know, love to do, so to speak, is to, you know, take a group of people and abandon them on an island. Now, obviously, we can't do that. It's, but monarchs
make a reality TV show.
Yes. And in fact, I talk about some of those examples of, you know, survivor type situations that, and, you know, this has been called the forbidden experiment because we're not the first people to think about it. Herodotus talks about an Egyptian pharaoh that was wondering what was the kind of language we were innately pre-wired. You know, was Egyptian the language we just had to speak? And so he contrived the experiment of taking some babies and assigning them to the care of a mute shepherd up in the mountains to just see what kind of language would these babies speak when they grew up. And, you know, multiple monarchs have tried this, are said to have tried this over the centuries. But obviously, it's a cruel and brutal and unethical experiment. It's the forbidden experiment. So the experiment is forbidden to us. So what can we do instead? So, well, what I did is I looked systematically or broadly, and then I chose selectively examples that are in the book of different kinds of circumstances in which we were trying to see if you throw a bunch of people together and they're left to their druthers, what kind of social order do they make? So the second chapter of the book begins with shipwrecks, unintentional communities, groups of people who have been stranded on an island or on a coast and are tasked with making some social order. And between 1500 and 1900, I was able to find 20 cases in which at least 19 people had been stranded for at least 2 months unintentionally. You know, they didn't set out to do this. They were thrown on this island. And then I got all the records I could about them and the archaeological excavations of the wreck sites and tried to make some inferences about what kind of social order did they make. And then the next chapter considers intentional communities, you know, people who like set out deliberately. Maybe you, like we were talking about earlier, you know, our utopian inklings, they set out, you know, to set up communes, you know, utopian communes. And people have been doing this since at least Roman times, you know, have been saying this society is screwed up. You know, I'm going to go make my own society. And I look at those examples. I look at the Pitcairn, you know, Mutiny on the Bounty and the Pitcairn settlement. I look at colonies or groups of scientists who have self-isolated on the South Pole. You know, they have to live together for 10 months. You know, what kind of social order do they make? What kind of networks do those scientists make? Some of those pictures are in the book. I look at kibbutzes. I look at a variety of examples of that. And then in the fourth chapter, I talk about artificial societies. And here I use some of our own work looking at online communities, for example, virtual, you know, like Second Life and World of Warcraft, stuff like that. But also some experiments we've been doing in my laboratory over the last 10 years in which we've written this software that allows us to create temporary artificial societies of real people. Over 20,000 research subjects have come through our lab, have been dropped into this little world and various worlds. And we've experimented with, you know, what happens when you put people in an unequal society versus an equal one? We give them real money and some people are made rich and poor and we vary the Gini coefficient and so forth. And after I'm looking at all of this, the argument that I make is that actually the variation is extremely small. The kind of social order that we make occupies a tiny fraction of the parameter space. You know, like if you imagine parameterizing this space of all kinds of social order you might get, you think that actually people have many different ways of living, but they do not, in fact, have many different ways of living socially. So the question is how and why did that come to pass?
So culture is not infinitely malleable. Is that what you're saying to one degree?
Some elements are, you know, for example, adornment, patterns of adornment, but some elements are not. So every culture we go to, we find love and friendship. And I look at the cross-cultural evidence for these things and cooperation, for instance, to differing degrees within a certain range and so on. Every culture we go to, we find teaching and learning. So these are why these items belong, I think, in the social suite. When we go to every culture, we find the capacity for religion everywhere, but of course we don't find the same religion everywhere. So that's how I try to get at, you know, the underlying core features. Incidentally, this idea about, you know, is there a universal human culture is another topic that anthropologists have been thinking about for at least a century. And I review some of that in the book as well. And there's a kind of sense in which if you could itemize, like we mentioned, adornment. So you can talk about all the patterns of adornment and all the patterns of subsistence and all the patterns of political organization and all the patterns of, you know, magical thinking. And you make a long list of religion and, you know, do you have many gods or are you polytheistic or monotheistic? And you array all of these traits and look at all the combinations of these traits. there are more combinations than there are stars in the universe, truly. And yet, when you anthropologists fan out across the globe, they don't find every possible combination. They only find a small subset of the combinations. And once again, I think this is for evolutionary reasons.
That's fascinating. Something else I was really happy that you brought into the artificial communities discussion, a discussion of The Time Machine, because that was like my favorite book growing up as a kid. And I used to write different, I used to be in a creative writing as a kid, and I used to write different alterations of that and different universes of that. So how, like, that social arrangement, like, do you think that's like a fair representation of like how human nature would react? Like, is that actually like, science fiction, but.
Well, I mean, I look at science fiction as well as a source of ideas for different types of social arrangements. And there's a sort of, I had written a whole chapter on that, and that got cut down to a few pages. This book was like twice as long as it is now originally, if you can believe it.
And believe it. Trust me, writing a book. Yeah.
It's really hard to get it shorter. And it's 120 or 125,000 words. And it was originally like 200,000 words. And my editor just, you know, had a conniption.
Yeah.
God bless her, Tracy. I would have written as my editor is Tracy Behar, but as Mark Twain said, right, I would have written a shorter book, but I didn't have the time. I think he said I would have written a shorter letter, but I didn't have the time. But anyway, so it's hard to get things down. So anyway, I had a long, long section on science fiction, which I love science fiction.
Me too.
And usually one of the very common tropes in science fiction is that, you know, when they're trying to make a creepy social arrangement, they have us live socially like insects, right? So that's considered to be really creepy. And no mammal lives, you know, and part of the reason, of course, is all the eusocial insects are clones. So we have a different challenge of living socially because we're all genetically different, whereas, you know, the termites and the wasps and the bees and the ants, they're clones. So that is different. Anyway, so I look at science fiction. I look at the Time Machine, which is, you know, extraordinary levels of hierarchy in that society. And
that's for sure.
Yeah, too much, right? That we have mild hierarchy, as we were talking about earlier. So, anyhow.
Well, it'd be amazing to see if humans last that long.
I don't think that's in our future. No, I think you want us to be cannibalizing each other? You want
No. What I was saying is, like, you know, I forget the date that he went in the future, but it'd be interesting to see if humans still.
100,000 years.
I'm saying, will Homo sapiens still be there in 100? That's all I'm saying.
I think if we don't nuke ourselves, or we don't have a kind of machine intelligence, it's possible. Of course, this is total speculation. It's possible that a million years from now, the world will be populated by sentient machines, and we will either be dead or enslaved, and those machines will think about us the way we think about, you know, single cell organisms, as being a kind of transitional phase in the distant past. Before we now have this sort of ascendant species on the planet. And those machines will think of us as, you know, as sort of the necessary transitional step before we get to the higher, you know, more perfect kind of arrangement.
Well, I would hope that the machines would have, you know, teach in their history classes in high school the fact that we're the ones that, like, you know, we created them.
Yes, we did. And but then, you know, now they're there. And, you know, like if chimpanzees could speak or think,
good point.
They might say, you know, our ancestors gave rise to these humans. Isn't that terrific?
It's such a good point.
Do you think that the chimpanzees that are in our cages or whose habitat we are destroying would be so grateful for having, you know, given rise to us? No. So now, of course, there's more volition in them. I mean, these are very speculative ideas. But if those don't happen, if we don't have nukes, we don't kill ourselves this way or some other way. Globally, and if we don't give rise to these machines, I think that our species will continue to evolve, but will be about as different 100,000 years from now, from us now, as we are now from 100,000 years ago, Homo sapiens sapiens. And that's the prediction I'm going to make, and anyone who proves me wrong can come back and let me know.
Well, you know, maybe in our lifetime someone will create a time machine, who knows?
I doubt that.
It's unlikely. Thought of a good segue to what you were just talking about, because you do, you know, just to be a little more hopeful about how we treat other primates, you do have a whole section in your book on primate friendships that I thought was very touching. I thought maybe you could talk about elephant friendships a little bit.
The book looks at length at social order in other social mammals, and one of sort of the meta arguments that I try to make in the book is that if we can share the capacity for friendship with elephants, we can share it with each other. In fact, paradoxically, the more similar we are to these other animals, the greater and deeper our understanding of our own common humanity can be. You know, we are all human beings, and we share these deep and fundamental qualities, all of us, with each other. And the proof of that is actually the fact that, you know, like I said, if we're similar to elephants, we must be similar to each other. And these elephants, you know, which have been beautifully studied by Cynthia Moss and Joyce Poole, two of the leading ethologists of elephants, whose work I really admire. Also Sherman De Silva, who's a young ethologist, a young elephant expert who I hope to collaborate with, who's done some amazing work with the elephants in Sri Lanka. You know, these elephant sort of studying or looking at elephants can give us paradoxically insights into ourselves. So the book has a long exploration of elephant society, of chimpanzee society, of orca and dolphin society. I have a great admiration for the ethologists that study cetaceans. I mean, I think I have problems with data collection. Imagine if your research has to take place, you know, if your study of the social organization has to take place, you know, like you would have to work, you know, in the cold and underwater to observe your subjects. Now, ethologists who study whales like Hal Whitehead or David Lousseau, whose work I also greatly admire, who mapped the networks of these animals and studied their communication patterns and so forth, you know, do that. Anyway, so the point, though, is that it's fascinating to look at these animals and how they interact with each other. But furthermore, it's also interesting that our relationships to social animals is rather different than our relationships to non-social animals. Mm. And so there's an interesting history of examples of human-animal friendships, typically between humans and animals that themselves live socially, or at least in groups. So a lot of the creatures that we befriend, so, you know, there's Jane Goodall's relationship with David Greybeard, the first chimpanzee that befriended her, and she speaks of him as her friend. Or our relationships with our pets, you know, dogs and horses, for example, are herd animals. Now, cats, as usual, is a special exception, you know. Yeah. But anyway, I don't want to push it too far. But the point is that we have a capacity for friendship that we even sometimes apply across species to our pets.
Yeah, and it's a very good point, and it's nice to kind of like shift our perspective, like zoom out. You know, zoom in your book, and you also zoom out. It's constantly, I feel like you're constantly going back and forth. You know,
yes.
It's really cool. So let's zoom out again to humans and our natural and social laws. You know, you make the argument. Well, a lot of people have made this argument, but you emphasize that our evolution has shaped not just our bodies and minds, but also our societies. And you know, I think about like how we've designed our society and how we justify various aspects of our justify various manifestations of our human nature. You know, one question you ask in the world is, how is God to be justified in the face of all the evil in the world? You know, how do you answer that? How do you answer that question?
Well, I'm not a theologian, but I refer, I make use to some of these struggles that the theologians have had. So that's what is known as the problem of theodicy. How is God to be vindicated or justified in the face of the manifest evil and suffering in the world? And I'm not a pangloss, right? I'm not like a Pollyanna, you know, thinking this is the best of all possible worlds. And, you know, because I'm fully aware that every century is replete with horrors. You know, we've had the Inquisition, and we've had pogroms, and we've had the Holocaust, and we've had, you know, horrible leaders, and we've had Pol Pot, and, you know, and the Rwanda genocide. And I mean, it's just awful. We are also awful, we humans. We are awful to each other. We are vile and full of hatred and propensity to violence and everything else. So I'm well aware of all of this. So in theology, this is seen as a problem of theodicy. How can a beneficent God or omniscient or omnipotent God possibly permit such suffering or evil? And the theologians struggle with this. It's a kind of branch of theology. But I see Blueprint as a work of sociodicy. It's a vindication of our way of being social despite all the failings of our living socially. How are we to come to understand the good in human society despite the bad? And another analogy might be by reference to this Japanese philosophy and aesthetic known as wabi-sabi, which is to see, it's this aesthetic, you know, in Western aesthetics, we might value symmetry and perfection, but there's a branch of Japanese aesthetics that sees imperfection as very beautiful. So the, a pot that has a little crack in it, or a bent tree, for example, especially natural phenomena, or, you know, a cobblestone street that's beautiful because it's imperfect, right? There's a kind of beauty to a cobblestone street. So that's the argument I would make about society. I think society is beautiful and full of beautiful things like love and cooperation and friendship and teaching, despite its imperfections. In fact, in some ways, maybe those things are even more beautiful or more perfect given our imperfections. So I see this as a work of sociodicy. It's a vindication of our confidence in the good of society despite its failings.
It's a very hopeful. Yeah, you believe in humanity. I mean, that's why you scored high on my light triad scale, where one of the facets is literally faith in humanity. You know?
Yes. My mother was she was originally trained as a physical chemist. She died when I was 25 and I was 47. And I tell some stories about her in the book here and there. And she went back to school in the 1970s. She was working on her PhD in physical chemistry at Yale in the 60s. And she went back to school to Howard University in Washington, D.C. To get a PhD in clinical psychology in the 70s. So while she was training, before she died, she would use us children as guinea pigs. So I took the thematic apperception test. I took the MMPI. I took all the WISC intelligence tests. The Rorschach test. I had every damn test administered to me during my preteen years that you can imagine. And I acquired from that a kind of healthy respect and amusement by these tests. So when you said, "Would you like to take my test?" I'm like, "Yes, I would love to take your test."
Yes.
And so I did. And, you know, I don't know what it means exactly, but, you know, I was happy to do it.
It just confirms the sort of spirit that underlies your book.
Okay.
Yeah, you know, this
sort of... I'm not a hypocrite.
No, you're not a hypocrite. I wanted to get your thoughts about something because I wanted to circle back. I feel like I left something unsaid and I wanted to bring it up and get your thoughts. You know, because I can tend to be, you know, have this sort of very hopeful spirit, and then, you know, I'll talk to someone who's like, you know, really, really suffering right now, like maybe... maybe they are part of like an oppressed group, or like a group that like it might be rightly so to actually hate the particular outgroup.
I don't believe that. I don't believe that. I don't believe in collective justice. That's what the Nazis did. You know, one member of a Cretan village would kill a Nazi, and then the Nazis would come in and wipe out the village as kind of a collective punishment. If you believe in collective justice, you are not doing justice right. So I don't think that you can blame one person for the sins of another. I mean, that's not justice. It's something else. It might be public policy. You know, we might want to do that anyway, but I don't think that is a kind of justice. I mean, would you spank one of your children if another child, I don't think any children should be spanked. I'm using this as hypothetical. You know, we customarily think of punishment redounding to the individuals who committed the delict. You know, we don't punish one person for the actions of another.
So I have like this visceral hatred for like Nazis, for instance, you know. And so would you make the case that I should get rid of that hate for that particular outgroup, or like, you know, like white supremacists, like don't instill in me a great feeling of love? Are you saying I should have more, like I should, what do you think I should do?
First of all, there's a distinction between words and deeds. Okay. So I'm not saying you need to like these people or respect them even. You can avoid them, ignore them, and so forth. I think that when you do something, you know, when you touch another person in some way, I mean, you know, hit them or kill them, for example, we have well understood procedures that are philosophically grounded and evolutionarily shaped for punishment. So I think you can hold people responsible for their beliefs. You know, you can say you have for example, think about the people who are opposed to vaccination. Think about the anti-vaxxers. You know, we can say you have a set of beliefs which are dangerous to yourself and to others. And, you know, let's try to talk to you to persuade you to change your mind about your beliefs. So I'm not saying you're prohibited from having disliking people who...
Or even hateful feelings.
Yes, I think it's okay. I don't think it's healthy. I don't think it's necessary to have those hateful feelings. I mean, you know, if you look at one of my favorite examples, there was this study by neuroscientists at MIT about 10 years ago. I should look it up again, in which they did MRI scans of Buddhist monks. And they showed that certain parts of the brain, I can't remember which parts right now, were hyperdeveloped. And so there were certain brain patterns. Maybe they did EEG studies. I don't remember right now what they did exactly. But the gist was that the brains of these monks were different than you and me. But that wasn't what was interesting to me. What was interesting to me is they interviewed the monks. They interviewed the monks. And one of the monks told the following story, which I still remember now. I read this 10 or 20 years ago, whenever it was. And I've been thinking about it ever since. So they talk about, how does this monk do this? And the monk said, well, you know, I'm constantly re-narrating the world around me. And he said, for example, let's say you're driving in traffic and a person cuts in front of you. Now, you and I might say, that person's an asshole, right? But what the monk does is the monk says, you know, maybe that person, his wife is in the car and she's delivering a baby and he's racing to the hospital to get the baby to the hospital. And isn't it wonderful that the new life is about to be brought into the planet, and totally re-narrates the whole thing. And he's not doing it for the sake of that person. He's doing it for himself, for his own experience of the world. Now, I think it does also, when you do that, it does create positive externalities. I think you're more likely to be able to reach a better world. And again, I'm not naive. I'm not saying we shouldn't crush the Nazis, right? I mean, I'm not saying that, you know, people who wish to, you know, who set out to kill us, we must defend ourselves. But I am saying that, you know, I think we need to judge people. I don't think we do ourselves any favors by forming group level hatreds. You know, now there are, I don't want to be, you know, if you want to form individual level dislikes, that's fine. And if you want to form group level dislikes, that's okay. It might not be great for you or our society. But if you want to form group level hatreds, I don't think that's good for you, and I don't think that's good for our society.
So thanks for offering that perspective. I'm really, truly trying to wrap my head around all the implications of what you just said. And thank you for stimulating my brain. I just want to just think this through. So there's great power in the collective, more so than just the individual. Like, let's say that there's like a real social inequality that a particular group, like, you know, is like, we really want to address this because people who are like us, you know, like racism, maybe one example. So couldn't one make the argument that like there is power in the collective of people coming together to fight systemic racism? Like, would that be an example? Like, what would you say to that? I'm just curious.
I think that's great. I mean, I think, and I talk about civil rights movement in the book, and I talk about how in fact, our capacity for collective action, which is ingrained in us, can be harnessed as a force for both good and evil, right? I mean, you can create witch hunts and mobs by groupiness, or you can create a positive change in society. You know, groups are very powerful, and our capacity to form these groups and to suspend our individuality, which is also an interesting trait. You know, as you well know, I'm sure, we can de-individuate when we're in groups, right? We can lose ourselves in the group and surrender our own agency to the will of the group. And that's how mobs form, and riots and panics and all kinds of other well-known, I won't say they're totally well-understood phenomena. So absolutely, groups can be a force for good. But, you know, we can also get genocide from groups, right? We get the Hutus and the Tutsis massacring each other. So the question is how to harness those powers effectively. And, you know, my book is not a work of politics. Like, I don't go into specifically how that might be done, but I do certainly explore the undercurrents for how that might be. Now, in the question of racism in our society, you know, I think racism has been present. It's, again, a manifestation of in-group bias. It's been present in every single society, in every single group since time immemorial. And it's really depressing.
It sucks.
And we're not the only society. In fact, if anything, we are one of the best societies in addressing issues of racism. We have we have our own distinctive history, of course, with slavery. But, you know, there's been slavery again since time immemorial. Groups have enslaved other groups, you know, in every continent, in every century. So.
And we slave other animals, other primates.
Well, that's another whole story.
I know.
And stick with humans, okay. You know, which is obviously very important. But so I think the challenges are real. I think we need to work together to address them. I think we are equipped with qualities that we can use to make political changes in our society. And I would highlight our capacity for recognizing our common humanity. I think to the extent that we can see that we're all human beings, that we have this shared humanity. It provides us a very powerful lever for positive social change and actually for improvements in our society.
I'm right there with you on this idea of common humanity. I think that your book lays out that case really persuasively, and it's an important message in this day and age. You know, I also am a big fan of loving kindness, like Buddhist meditation, and I try to practice it even on my enemies. So I think that's kind of one of the points you're trying to make there, of just recognizing the common humanity, even if I want to, you know, like I don't have to like accept bullying, you know, like I don't have to just, you know, I can still loving kindness for the person and also try to make healthy changes so that I am not being hurt.
And you can incarcerate them if they hurt you,
correct,
right?
Correct.
Not if they say mean things to you,
correct.
You can't incarcerate them. But if they hurt you, yes. I think that's a well understood kind of
thing. I hope that we make that clear, yes. So I want to end today on two quotes of yours from your book that I think kind of sum up a lot of what we talked about today. Quote, "We are primed for conflict and hatred, but also for love, friendship, and cooperation. If anything, modern societies are just a patina of civilization on top of this evolutionary blueprint." And then you say, "We should be humble in the face of temptations to engineer society in opposition to our instincts. Fortunately, we do not need to exercise any such authority in order to have a good life. The arc of our evolutionary history is long, but it bends towards goodness." So thank you for shining a spotlight on the human potential for goodness.
Thank you so much for having me. I had a really good time talking to you.
Me too. Thanks for listening to the Psychology Podcast. I hope you enjoyed this episode. If you'd like to react in some way to something you heard, I encourage you to join in the discussion at thepsychologypodcast.com. That's thepsychologypodcast.com. Also, please add a rating and review of the Psychology Podcast on iTunes. Thanks for being such a great supporter of the podcast, and tune in next time for more on the mind, brain, behavior, and creativity.